Hi, I'm Bill Vass. I'm the Chief Technology Officer here at Booz Allen. Quantum computing, a lot of people are scared by quantum computing. And I think it's just important to point out that it's just another phase of computing. Now we're just advancing to use the properties of quantum with different types of quantum particles and leveraging the two magical parts of a quantum computer kind of are the physics around superposition and entanglement. It doesn't mean classical computers go away any more than me counting on my fingers went away. The two are going to work together and are going to reinforce each other. The biggest thing to remember about quantum computing is it's just another step forward. It'll range probably from 3 years to 7 years. And the reason that it's coming in more closely like that is because all of the different machines that are being developed today, they've learned how to do error correction. It's just a lot of work to do it. I think that's going to be transformational as they get error correction down. Remember, on a quantum computer, it's so affected by the environment it operates in. So it takes a tremendous amount of error correction code in proportion to the compute you put out there. So some of these early machines are going to be the size of data centers. Quantum computing will have its biggest near-term effect in material sciences, and I think that's important, physics, chemistry, and material sciences. And the reason for that is a quantum computer works like a molecule, if you like. You're basically building through superposition and entanglement quantum circuits in the memory of a machine. And so unlike a digital computer that we use today, a quantum computer works analog like a molecule, if you like. That's one way to think of it. So doing Hamiltonian simulations of material sciences as we get a small number of error-corrected qubits is going to be transformational. Things like high-energy storage systems, long-duration storage systems, high-temperature superconductors, new drugs, new materials that are lighter weight and handle more stress, new materials that potentially enable stealth or other technologies are going to be able to, for the first time, be reverse-engineered with a quantum computer. As more qubits become available, that's when quantum computers start to help in things like logistics, the traveling salesman program, all those other things, and ultimately put cryptography at risk. As quantum computers evolve to the point where they can break our current cryptography, it's the most important place to focus on is the places where someone could be recording data today to break it tomorrow, because secrets last a long time. We still have classified data from World War II, for example. What you want to do is focus on the areas where data could be transported in a cryptographic way. So for example, in communication, our TLS systems. TLS systems are transport layer encryption. In the future, will be able to be broken by a quantum computer. So what you want to do is start implementing post-quantum encryption on that in case someone is doing a recording of network traffic, where they could record it today and we don't worry so much about it because it's encrypted in a way that you know that it can't be broken. In the future, they could record it, keep it for 10 years, and then break it later. We're working to make the government ready for quantum computing and quantum technologies in a number of ways. So first of all is developing and implementing post-quantum cryptography and the ability to deploy that at scale, enabling quantum sensing and leveraging that at scale. And then last but not least, investing in companies like Seek and others that build the components for quantum computers and having a good understanding of how to build quantum circuits and manage and develop algorithms on quantum computers. So we're ready as more and more machines that are error corrected and stable become available. I think the biggest misconception I see out there about quantum computing is that it'll replace classical computing, because it won't. It augments classical computing. And I think some of the other hype you have to look at today is a lot of people talk about quantum AI. And once we have quantum memory storage, and that's being evolved, a quantum computer could potentially tremendously accelerate linear algebra, which is used for model training. So it has a potential to help in AI in a very big way. It's just a ways off from doing that today. I don't think you'll see a tremendous amount of AI in quantum computing yet, but it has a tremendous potential there. For us to maintain our leadership in quantum computing, there's a number of areas that we have to invest in. The most basic one is, of course, continuing to advance quantum sensors for things like GPS-denied environments and other things like that. Having quantum-based gyroscopes and other things like that are really, really important for IMUs and things like that. Another area, of course, is to now today invest in and start deploying quantum cryptography. That's really important. And then in quantum computing, to continue to invest in education in quantum computing, but also understand the supply chain for quantum computing to make sure the fab capabilities are there and the supply chain for the materials needed for quantum computing are there, along with just continuing to advance the skill sets in quantum computing. Quantum computing is a different way to compute. And it's incredibly important that the government be investing in the training and the understanding to keep the government and the United States a leader in quantum computing.